I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind. And that is closer now than it's ever been. And I can almost hear the trumpet.
Bibles, please, and turn to Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 20. Skip down there to verse about 17. You glad to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
Good. Good. Does your face know it? Let me see. Good. Good. You just have to see what I see sometimes. You say, well, you have to look at we have to look at you every week. I get it. That's a two-way street. But it's good to be in the house where we can, house of the Lord, we can worship together. I want to talk to you this morning about this. How do you serve the Lord in a crazy world? How do you serve the Lord in a crazy world. We have to admit, this world is seems to be out of control, doesn't it? Spiral, just going. And how do we serve the Lord in the midst of it? There's a lot of things going on around us, a lot of distractions. Have you noticed? I mean, it's a lot of distractions going on. A lot of obstacles, you know, things that we look and go, I can't serve here, I can't do that, I would do this, but I can't. A lot of opinions. Have you noticed a lot of opinions out there? You know, they always told me growing up, they always just say, you know, you get, you know, 10 Baptists, you're going to have 20 opinions. Well, that's true in the Baptist church, but it's also true in the world. There's all kinds of opinions out there, what we should do, what we should not do. And I found this to be true when it comes to serving the Lord. There's a lot of excuses. I've made them, you've made them, we've all made them. Excuses why we don't serve the Lord, why we don't follow Him and do certain things in our life. But the truth is this, that the same Jesus Christ that lived on this earth lived a life in the midst of His time here on this earth. He lived His life in a way that was obedient to the Father, right? I mean, He pleased the Father. Everything He did, He pleased the Father. He served the Father in everything that He did. And the truth is this, that if you know Jesus, you're saved, you've given your life to Christ, you're born again, that same Jesus lives in you. God lives in us. He indwells us. And so the truth is, you can serve like Jesus did. I can serve like Jesus did. But we find it maybe very difficult to see in our life sometimes how we can serve and be obedient to the Lord. So we have to look at the Lord, see how He served, and we're going to see that today. And again, and get some ideas on how He walked on this earth, how He lived, and how we can serve as well. And the truth of the matter is this, if you and I will get ourselves out of the way long enough to let Jesus Christ live through us, we will be obedient to do what God's called us to do. The problem, listen, the biggest problem I have is me. The biggest problem you have is you. The getting in the way of the Lord Jesus Christ doing what He wants to do in and through our life. So Matthew chapter 20 is a great illustration, I think, that can help us understand how we can be servants and how we can serve the Lord in this crazy world. The Bible tells us this, again, verse 17, now Jesus, going up to Jerusalem, took the 12 disciples aside on the road and said to them, behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and to the scribes, and they will condemn Him to death and deliver Him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify, and the third day He will rise again. Now, that's an amazing statement. What Jesus has done is this. He has taken His 12 disciples aside in the midst of all the things going on. He pulls them aside and He says, look, guys, here's what's happening. We're going now to Jerusalem. In a few short days, I'm going to be taken before all the people there. I'm going to be scourged, beaten, ridiculed, mocked. They're going to take me. They're going to put me on the cross. They're going to kill me. But rest assured, I'm coming back 3 days later. Now, you can see that conversation, right? I mean, it's more in depth than that. But He pulls them aside and just says, here's where we're going. Here's what's going on. It's a busy time, but here's what's happening. And His disciples got a little insight of that. But now look at verse 20. Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Him and with her sons, kneeling down and asking something from Him, something from Jesus. And He said to her, what do you wish? She said to Him, grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one on your right hand and the other on your left, in your kingdom. But Jesus answered and said, it's a great statement, you do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I'm about to drink? And be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said to Him, here's what they said, we are able. Verse 23, so He said to them, you will indeed drink my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared by my Father. And then when the ten heard it, the other disciples, they were greatly displeased with the two brothers. Can you imagine? They're going over there saying, look, let us be the greatest. Let us be above all these other guys, above everyone else. Let us, when you're right and you're left, just, Lord, let us do that. Now, the ironic thing of that is this. He's just got done telling them, I'm going to die. I'm getting ready to go to the cross. I mean, I'm getting ready to be just beaten and bruised and just they're going to kill me and put me on the cross. And their mother comes and says, hey, excuse me, Lord, can you give my two guys? If you're leaving, you know, you're getting ready to go to the kingdom, all that kind of stuff. Can you just give my guys right and left hand authority? Jesus said, it's not mine to give. Then the Bible says this, and when they heard it, they were greatly displeased. Verse 25, but Jesus called them to Himself and said, now here's what He says. You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your what? Servant. In other words, he said, in the real world out here, the people in authority rule over everybody. He said, but not so in my kingdom. That's what he says. He says this, they should be servants. Verse 27, and whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your what? Slave. We don't like using that word. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, here it is, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus came to the earth not for the ones he created to serve him, but he came to the earth to serve those that he created. And he's trying to help them understand. You guys don't understand the way things work in the kingdom. You might understand the way it works in the world, but you don't understand the way it works in the kingdom. Let me help you, he says. Your mama's coming in here trying to help you, but that's not what you need. And by the way, you will go through what I'm going through. But the right and the left of the kingdom, that's not for me. Then he says in verse 29, he says, now as they went out to Jericho, he's going to give them an illustration, a great multitude followed him. And behold, two blind men sitting by the road, when they heard that Jesus was passing by, cried out saying, here's what they said, have mercy on us, O Lord, Son of David. The multitude warned them that they should be quiet. But they cried out all the more, saying, have mercy on us, O Lord, Son of David. So Jesus stood still and called them and said, what do you want me to do for you? I love that. I love that. What can I do for you? That's just a great statement. They said to him, Lord, that our eyes may be open. So Jesus had compassion and touched their eyes. And immediately their eyes received sight and they followed him. We say it a lot. You ever say this? I am busy. I am busy. How many of you are busy? I'm setting you up, but anyway, that's good. How many of you are busy? Let me see. How many of you are really busy? My hand's up. I'm just saying, busy, right? We're all busy. Here's a good principle for you. If you don't get anything else, get this. Listen, your life, God's plan for your life does not change because of your busy schedule. Does that help you? I knew I should have stayed home today, right? I get it. Listen, just because you and I add things to our schedule to make ourselves really busy, that does not change God's plan for your life. God has a plan for you. He has a plan for me. He has a plan for us. And just because I tack on a bunch of things and get crazy busy in my life does not mean God looks at it and goes, well, I had something for you to do, but since you're really busy now, then I'll change it. No, we're talking about God. You don't dictate God's plan for you. I don't dictate God's plan for me. He's got a plan for our life. And just because you and I put a lot of things on our schedule and on our plate and get wore out and can't do anything for the kingdom, that's not God's problem. God has a plan for you and a plan for me. And it means being servant. Jesus, if Jesus Christ can come to this earth and say, I didn't come to this earth for you to serve me. The reason I came here was to serve and to give my life for you. That same Jesus, if he lives in me and he lives in you, he does the same thing. Which is evident of our life ought to be more serving and less being served. Amen? Yeah. All right. You're on the same page with me. Right. So here's the picture. Jesus comes on the scene. These guys sort of take him on the side and they say, look, Lord, we want to be great in your kingdom. Put us in the prominent spots. And Jesus said, I'll tell you the prominent spot. The most prominent spot for you, the most prominent spot for you and all of you would be this, to be a servant. That's what I am. That's what you need to be. And in my kingdom, that's how my kingdom works. My people serve. They don't sit back and wait for other people to wait on them. They serve. It's a great illustration. How do we have servants' hearts? How can we today in this crazy, mixed up, crazy world, how can we be servants? I mean, I've got them, you've got, we've all got the excuses, we've all got the reasons. But just because we've got the excuses and reasons, listen, God does not negate the fact that you and I are to be servants as believers. So I'm going to give you this, three things to give you. And these are deep. I went to school years to figure this out, how deep this stuff is, and to show you how smart I am. I'm going to give it to you. You ready? Amen. You ready? You know I'm not, you know, I'm just kidding. But watch this. I'm going to give you three things that's going to help you in the life of Jesus That's going to be, again, so overwhelmingly deep, you may not get it, but here it is. Number one, are you ready? If you're ready, say amen.
Amen.
Number one, how can I be a servant in this crazy world? Number one, we look at Jesus. And if I look at Jesus, I see Jesus served by stopping. I told you it's going to be deep. Jesus served by stopping. Look at what the Bible says in verse 32. So Jesus stood still and called them and said, what do you want me to do for you? Did you know what serving the Lord Jesus Christ, you know what it requires? Here it is. To stop. To pause. To hit the brake. Hit the brake in life. And notice what's going on around you. See, I don't think we're there. I think we're so confused because we're so busy, we don't stop at anything. The only time we stop in our world today is when our body shuts down. And the doctor says, you need to rest. You need to take a break. You've got this. You got to stop for a little bit and rest. And we go, okay, but I can't stop for long because I'm so busy. No. We are created to serve. And Jesus shows us here a simple principle. This is simple. It's not deep. It's just simple. Jesus stood still. He's on his way to Jerusalem. In a week, he's going to be crucified. He's ministered in Jericho. Very, very busy. How many of you think that redeeming mankind from their sins for all of eternity is a pretty busy job? It's a busy job. It's an important job. It's vital. No greater job can I ever think of in this life or the life than the Lord Jesus Christ as he was here on his way the last week of his life to die for the sins of mankind. Yet he stopped to help a guy in the midst of all this. Let me ask you a question. Do you see God at work at your life? In your life, do you see God at work? Do you see him doing anything? Can I tell you why sometimes we don't? We don't because we're too busy to see it. Amen. We're too busy to see the divine appointments that Jesus puts us in. We're too busy to stop and listen to folks who are hurting. We're too busy to listen and to see the areas around us, our family, our friends, at school, at work. We're too busy because we've got a schedule. We've got agendas. We've got a planner. We've got things that we've got to do that are priority. Are they really? I think one of the reasons we don't see God move in our life as much is because we're too busy. We're running too fast. We don't know what it means to stop. We don't know what it means to pause. We don't know what it means to take a break and look and see what God is doing around us. The Bible says in Psalm 46:10, be still and know that I am God. Listen, if you're on the move all the time, you're not still. You don't spend time with the Lord, you're not going to know anything about God. You can go on what you used to do. Listen, David is a great illustration in the Bible, isn't he? You know what? Listen, as a kid, you know, a young man, he was with the sheep. He was out there in God's country. He was just out there. He was playing the harp. He's writing hymns, psalms. I mean, he was just focusing on God, and God did wonderful things in his life. Then he got to be king. Got a little busy. In fact, got too busy. Took his eyes off the Lord, put his eyes on women, and as a result, got in trouble, didn't he? Put his eyes on everything but God, and he got in trouble. His life just went to a mess. Why? Because he forgot to be still and know that God was God. I think one of the problems with us serving today is that we're too busy, too much of a hurry. You know, Jeff Foxworthy used to do a thing called, you might be a redneck, you know, right? Y'all looking holy. Yeah, you know, you've heard that. You might be a redneck, give this and that and this and that. Well, I'm going to give you a couple things here that says you might be busy. Now, this is not the funny thing. It's just the things that I looked at and said, you know what? You might be too busy if these things are part of your life. Because you might be looking at me going, I'm not too busy. I got this. Okay. Number one, you might be too busy if you cannot remember what's next in your life. You say, well, what do you mean? Well, you don't know what's next. What are we going to do? I don't know. Talk to my wife. I don't know. Talk to so-and-so. I don't know what we're doing. I don't know what we're doing. I don't know what. It's just so busy. We just got all this going on. I don't know what's next. A lot of people like that. Wait, what's going on? I don't know. It's just crazy. When we have too much to remember that we can't remember it all, it might be a sign that we're just too busy. Another one is this. You might be too busy if you can no longer relax or you feel guilty and taking a break. You ever do that? You sit still and you're like, okay, I gotta have the TV on, I gotta have the radio on, I just can't sit here, I can't think if nothing's going on. You ever do that? There's just too much going on. If I sit still, I'm like, I gotta be here somewhere, I gotta be doing, I gotta talk to somebody, I gotta get on the phone, I gotta check my phone, what's going on? And before long, we can't sit still anymore. We can't be still and know that He's God. Or you can't remember the last time you took off. I say this all the time. I talk to people, when's the last time you took a day off? I don't know. And again, I said, follow up with this. Shame on you. Did you know you wasn't made to work at 100 miles per hour all the time of your life? We're teaching on Wednesday night with the kids. We talked about it the other day, the Sabbath day. God said, I need you to rest. I created you to rest. I'm giving the example to rest and focus on me. But not only do we not rest, but we don't focus on God. And then we wonder why, well, why is my life just going by so fast? Because we don't take a break. Another one is this. You might be too busy if those closest to you have stopped asking for your time. Or they complain about not getting time with you. Why bother? He's just too busy. Why bother? She's just too busy all the time. No reason to ask them. You might be too busy if it bothers you when other people are not as busy as you are. You ever see somebody, you ever do that? What's wrong with them? They're laying around, they're just lazy. They don't have my schedule. They don't know what I've been doing, you know? You ever do that? Just sort of judge other people as according to you, like you got it all down, right? And because they're not doing what you're doing or to the level you're doing it, there's something wrong with them, you know? You might be too busy if the only exercise you get is running from one commitment to the next. You get any exercise? Well, I got this, and I got to be here. I got my steps in, but it's only because I've been here, doing all these kind of things. I see this gets quiet. I know that. Now, you might be too busy if you have to multitask to get things done. I mean, we all do it. I've said it before, you know. I'm a multitasker, really. You know what I found with multitasking? This is just an opinion. You didn't ask for this. If you multitask all the time, you never do anything to the fullest extent. It's sort of that old term you used to use, jack of all trades, master of none. Because you got all these things going, you're multitasking, but you can never focus and get something done maybe the way it needs to be done. Or you can't keep your eyes off your phone. What's a good one, isn't it? You never shut down. You have to eat and do something else all the time. You have to eat and watch TV. You have to eat and go here. You have to eat on the run. You have to do all these kind of things because you're busy, you know. Fast food, right? Fast food. And you're eating it before you get out of the parking lot because you got somewhere to go and somewhere to do, something to do. You might be too busy if you have less time for God than you used to. Other meetings, other things, appointments. The kingdom of God has taken a back seat in your priorities because you're so busy. Good indication. And then another one is this. You might be too busy if you have less or no time to help and minister to other people. I would help them, but I've got to go. I would do that, but I've got to be here. I would, but. You might be too busy. Someone said our adversary, the devil, majors in three things: noise, hurry, and crowds. Why is that? Because you can't be still. You can't think. You can't think. I told you before, the old word amuse, means not. Muse, to think. When we're amused, we're not thinking. We're just amused. That's the enemy. If he can keep it noisy, you're thinking about everything else. If he can keep you in a hurry, you're thinking about everything else. If you're in crowds, you're thinking about all the other things around you. Carl Jung, psychologist, said this, hurry is not of the devil, hurry is the devil, he said. Hurry. We'll do anything, buy anything to make time go faster and just quicker and save us time in things. The best-selling shampoo in America rose to the top, they said, because it combined, listen to this, it combined shampoo and conditioner all in one. You know what I did? You don't have to rinse in between. Are you kidding me? Domino's Pizza became one of the, again, at that point, became one of the fastest rising pizza places. Why is that? Because they said this. They said, we will deliver your pizza in 30 minutes or you get it free. You know what the CEO said? He said, we don't specialize in pizza. We specialize in delivery. Why? Because people are in a hurry. Always in a hurry. But you know about Jesus? Jesus was never in a hurry. It's, I look at my Bible and I study about Jesus, I never see him in a hurry. He never looks at his disciples and goes, hurry up, come on, let's go, 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 gotta go, gotta go. Peter, get out of bed. We gotta go. I'm late, I gotta be there. You don't see him do that. I look at Jesus, I just like Jesus. He's just cool. Just a good word, cool. He's in no hurry. Now, other people around him are in a hurry, but he's just like, you know, Lazarus is dead. Yeah, okay, we'll be there in a little bit. He's in a hurry now. He's sick, right? We're sick. We got to get there. We'll get there in a little bit. He's dead. It'll be okay. We'll get there. I mean, even in the most dramatic circumstances, Jesus was just never in a hurry. The key is this. Jesus always took time to stay connected to the Father. That's why he had time to love and to be with people. Let me say it again. Jesus always stayed connected to his Father. That's why he always had time to love and to serve people. Let me reword it. If you disconnect from the Father, you will never have time for people, and you will never have time to love others. Because, you know, here's why. It's all about you at that point. It's all about what you need, what you want, what people can give you, what you can get from them. That's the total opposite of what Jesus did. What happens when you stop? You notice things different, don't you? When you pause a little bit, you notice things differently. I talk to guys all the time. We were talking about it a while ago. That's why guys, some guys go hunting. They like to hunt, deer hunt, whatever. They're out there. It's quiet. Nothing's around. You can't move around. You're just going to sit there. And they go, oh, it's so great. You think it's about killing deer. It's about just being quiet. To get out there and just relax and peaceful and see the hand. I'm not saying everybody's like that, but I'm saying just being quiet and still gives you a different perspective. It lets you think about things you hadn't thought about in a while. It sort of clears your mind as you commune and talk with God. That needs to go on in our life, again, not in a deer stand all the time. It needs to go on every day of our life as we connect to the Father and spend time with him. Ironically, though, when we get so busy in our life, we find a need to eliminate things in our life, don't we? Right? I mean, you can only do so much. But you know what I find in the Christian life? It's interesting. The things that get eliminated first, watch this, are many the things of God. I'm just so busy, I can't pray. I'm just so busy, I can't read my Bible. I'm just so busy, I can't go to church. I'm so busy, I can't help. I'm so busy, I can't serve. I'm so busy, I can't. I'm so busy, I can't. And before long, what we don't realize is that connection to the Father and service to other people is what helps us and strengthens us in our Christian life. Amen. The enemy knows exactly what he's doing. Exactly what he's doing. He's not going out trying to get you drunk. He's trying to keep you busy so you won't connect with the Father. And if you don't connect with the Father, then you don't connect with people. If you don't have those connections, you're out there just spinning your wheels, waking up one day going, what happened in my life? He knows what he's doing. We've become so conformed to the world, we've got to spend time with the Lord, back with him, and get conformed in our hearts with the Word. There was a pastor that moved to a new church field. The pace of his life was much faster, bigger church. He called a wise, trusted friend of his and told him about the problems he's having in his family and really the problems he's having in his heart. He said, my heart's cold. I'm just having trouble with my Christian walk. He said, I need some help. What do I need to do, he said to this man. He said, what do I need to do to be spiritually healthy again? After a long pause, his friend looked at an older man, looked at him and said, He said, you must. He paused. His pastor's like, yeah. said, you must eliminate hurry from your life. Young pastor looked at him and said, eliminate hurry. Okay, quick. What else? He had a lot going on. He had a lot going on. The old gentleman looked at him after a pause for a long time and said, no, there's nothing else. Just eliminate hurry. What are you hurried about? Are you hurried today? Most of us today, the great danger in our life is not turning our back on our faith. The great danger of our life is becoming so distracted and rushed and preoccupied that we skim through this life and never live for the glory of the Lord. Amen. And you wake up one day and you're older and you look back and go, where in the world did my life go? When if we would stop and pause, God would give us direction. Jesus served by stopping. Number two, Jesus served by seeing. By seeing. I told you these are deep. Jesus served by seeing. Look at verse 30. The Bible says, and behold, two blind men. Interesting that he served by seeing, but he served two blind men. Sitting by the road, when they heard that Jesus was passing by, cried out saying, I love this, have mercy on us, O Lord, Son of David. And the multitude warned them that they should be quiet. In other words, they're saying, shut up. Can you see the picture? They're out here, and they heard, they can see him, Lord, I know you're, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And they're like, just shut up, be quiet, shh. Like a Baptist church when somebody says amen. Who said amen? You know? Somebody raises their hand. What did they do, raise their hand over there? Not this church, but other churches. They're saying, be quiet. He's coming through. Don't bother him, right? So I love this. So Jesus stood still and called them and said, what do you want me to do for you? They said to him, Lord, that our eyes may be open. So he had compassion and touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him. I guess they did, didn't they? Hey, if you've been blind for a long time and somebody came and said, hey, now you're healed, you'd probably give them some attention, wouldn't you? We'll follow him. The blind people in those days, what they would do is this. They were blind, and so they would set up outside the outskirts of the city. And they would do that because, at those gates in that, because the travelers would come in town. And they always thought that the traveler would have money. If he's on the road, he's going to have money. So they would sit outside the outskirts, and they'd say, alms, poor, I'm blind, help me. And so the people would give them money. These men looked and said, this might be their last opportunity. And they've heard about Jesus. We know one of these from Mark was Bartimaeus, blind Bartimaeus, right? He's one of these guys. And as he's there, they're calling out thinking, you know, we got one shot. We heard he heals people. We hear he's the Son of David. We hear he's the Messiah. He's the Lord. And they're calling out to him. And what the Lord does here is interesting. He sees these guys. You say, well, that's easy. No. Well, how often do you see needs around you? See, I love the Lord. He stopped, and he looked, and he saw these guys. Do you understand? There's a lot of people around Jesus at this point. Yet he singles out these two, and he ministers to them, first of all, by stopping, and then by seeing. The crowd tries to hush him. But again, Jesus' perspective on these two men was different than the perspective of the world around them. See, the guys around them said, shut up, be quiet. And Jesus' perspective was different. See, they looked at these guys as a bother. They looked at these guys as a nuisance. They looked at these guys as pariah. They looked at these guys as just people who were just not worthy to even be talking to Jesus. Yet Jesus looked and said, no, these are exactly the ones I'm going to talk to. He saw them. The crowd tries to hush them. Jesus ministers to them. You know why? Because Jesus sees people different. Listen to me. How does Jesus see people? Let's think for a moment. How does he see people? Because here's the key to this. If Christ lives in you and me, then you and I need to start seeing people like Jesus sees them. Don't you think so? I mean, again, if he stops in the middle of going to the cross I think I can stop in the middle of going to a meeting. Amen. Or your job. Or your school. Or in class. Or whatever. And we've got to understand that. We've got to see people and see people how Jesus, how did he see them? We know John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world, and I think we know that verse so much that we forget what it really means. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. That's how God sees you. That's how God sees me. Pretty good thing. The Bible says in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Listen, Jesus saw you a long way off, and he said, I'm still going to die. Because I love him. I love her. God demonstrated his love. You want to know how much God loves you? Look at the cross. You want to know how much God loves you? Look at Jesus. You want to know how much God loves you? Look at what he did for you on the cross. That's how God loves you. And that's how we've got to see other people. In love. 1 John 4:16. We love him. Why? Because he first loved us. The only reason you love him is because somebody told you he loved you first. Let me give you another verse, John 15:12. Jesus said, this is my commandment. Watch this, commandment. Say commandment. Amen. All right, it's not an option. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You mean to tell me you love me enough to give your life for me on a cross and sacrifice everything? You didn't need me to serve you. You're going to serve me by giving your life for me. And Jesus said, yep, and I'm going to command you, Ron. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to go do the same thing. Just as I've loved you, that's how you are to love other people. Yeah, but Lord, you know, what if they do? God demonstrated his love that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Yeah, but they're not very nice people. Mm-mm. But God demonstrated his love towards us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Yeah, but you don't know what they said. Yeah, but he still died for you, even though you were a sinner. That's how much he loves you. And I'm to love. Take your Bible. Flip over to Romans real quick. Romans chapter 8. Let's just look at this. I want to read a couple of verses. I want you to read it in your Bible. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Romans 8, 31. This will help you a little bit. If you're questioning how we should see people and really how God sees us. The Bible says in Romans 8, verse 31, what then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? What a great question. In other words, you say, oh, I've done this and that. Let's stop for a moment. What in the world can separate us from the love of Jesus? Watch. Not just Jesus, the love of Jesus. Watch. Shall tribulation? And the answer with that is no. Or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? No. As it is written, for your sake, we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him, through Jesus, who loved us. There it is. See that? You know why you're a conqueror? You know why you're getting through? You know why heaven is your home? Because of Jesus. Amen. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Absolutely, positively, nothing in this world or the life to come, past, present, future, whatever, can separate us from the love of Christ. And that Jesus lives in you. And that Jesus lives in me. Do we see people like that? Or do we judge them? Tell you what, I would help them, but they're going to go spend it on alcohol. Right? I would help them, but, you know, they need to go get a job. I would help them, but it's the name before long. It's just excuse after excuse after excuse after excuse. And every time I preach this, somebody will come up to me and go, yeah, but pastor, don't give them the buts. I don't believe in the buts. It's what he said. So we're to love the way Jesus loved. See, here's what Jesus did. They were going to stone a woman one time for being caught in the very act of adultery. Pretty big, stressful deal. And yet, they walked away, and Jesus picked her up and said, "Who condemns you?" And she said, "No one, Lord." He said, "I don't either. Go and sin no more." That's how much he loved people. And see, that's the love that helps us serve. That's the love. I mean, yeah, Jesus sees them. He stops. He sees these guys. And see, you and I, as a perspective, we look and we go, here's how we look at life. We look at, okay, here's my birth, which I don't remember. How many of you remember being born? I don't remember anything about that. I've heard stories, but I don't know anything about it. My mom and dad's in here. They can tell me stories about it. I don't know anything about it. I was there, but I don't understand it. And then we talk about death. No, I don't want to talk about that. That's down the road. I'm not going to talk about that. No one wants to talk about that. So my best is to do what I can do right now. But see, Jesus gives a different perspective of that. Jesus looks and says, no, Ron, this life is a preparation of the life to come. There's an eternal life that passes this life. You're to do what you do and to serve and to live like you live for the glory of God today, because there's coming a day for all of eternity that we'll spend together. And what you do on this earth makes a difference in people's lives today. God uses you. He uses me as children of God to serve others and seeing him come to the Lord. When we get a perspective like that, God uses us in powerful ways. There is nothing greater in your life, in your Christian walk, than when God uses you powerfully. I mean, it's all God. He does all the work. But he chooses to use us, which is amazing. Let me give you a verse. Acts 4, verse 32. It's a New Testament church. Listen to what happened in the New Testament church. Now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. And with great power the apostles gave witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Verse 34, was there anyone among them who lacked? For all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold and laid them at the apostles' feet, and they were distributed to each as anyone had need. Wow. Well, that's not today. No, that's New Testament. That's New Testament, you know, because I know people don't have land and things like that they can sell and help people. I know that, yeah. No, the truth is, we're all living way above our means in some form and fashion. And the truth is, as we look and to see the needs around us, God has given us more than enough in our lives to help minister to the world today. But what we've done is we've turned that over to the government. Hello, how's that working? That don't work.
Amen.
You know, our job is to care for people, minister to people, serve people, all from day one. New Testament church, that's been our calling. That's been our job. Here's a good question. Who is it around you that you're overlooking? Anybody in your sphere of influence that you sort of overlooked because you're too busy to see them? Things are going so fast, you think, well, I have... Or you throw out the drive-by prayers, right? Lord, help them in Jesus' name. Lord, I hear it. Oh, yeah, I'll pray for you in Jesus' name. No. What do we need to do to have a servant's heart? Jesus getting arrested soon, trial soon, crucifixion. But it takes time to minister to these two guys. Amazing. Let me give this last thing quickly and I'm done. Jesus, how do you have a heart? Like, how do you serve like Jesus? You stop. You see. You know, here's the third one. Ready? Jesus served. You know how he did it? This is deep. Ready? He served by serving. He did it. We talk about service so much. We talk about doing so much and do very little. Jesus did it exactly what he was supposed to do. He stopped. He saw the need. He loved the men, and he served them. It's a simple principle, isn't it? We've got to stop long enough to see what God's doing, to see the people as God sees them and love them, have compassion. The Bible says here of Jesus, have compassion on them, and then do what we can through the power of God to meet that need. That's what Jesus did. Verse 34. So Jesus had compassion, touched their eyes, and immediately their eyes received sight and they followed him. Compassion. love, the word compassion, a heartfelt attitude toward a need that requires us to take an action. Do you know a heart of compassion cannot be neutral when it comes to helping people? If you and I have a true heart, the heart of Christ, the mind of Christ, again, to get in there and say, you know what, I love them the way that Jesus loved them. There's no way in the world that we will not serve others. Amen. You just can't do it because your heart's going to go out to them. You're just going to go, man, I see them like Jesus sees them. And your heart goes there to help. Jesus sort of rejects the disciples' plea for the right hand and the left hand, but he receives, the plea from the beggars. See, that's the great servant. And I'm so thankful he did, because one day I was a beggar. You know, I was a beggar. Oh, Lord, forgive me. I got nothing. I got nothing. I'm poor in spirit. I'm dead to you. I need you. Forgive me. Come into my life and save me. I was a poor, desperate little beggar, and he blessed me. It's a great picture of how he lived and what he does in our lives today. We're done with this. How do you have a servant's heart like Jesus? You stop, you see, and you serve. Here are my last two questions. You ready? If you could witness to any person in your sphere of influence, who would it be? If there was one person that you would say, man, I really wish I could tell them about Jesus, who would that be? Another question. If you could serve one person, who would that be? If God has shown you a need in someone's heart and life, or just God, you stop, you pause, and the Holy Spirit of God through this message has been just putting someone in your mind and someone in your thoughts, and you just go, you know what, that person, I tell you what, I've missed it with them. Could it be God would open that door for you in the next few days to minister, to help, to serve, because maybe, just maybe, you can pull back and pause and see the need and see it like Jesus and serve them like Jesus would. I'll tell you what, it would change the way we live. It would change our families. It would change our friends, our schools. It would change everything we do at work. It would change us if we started serving Jesus in this crazy world and serving the way Jesus served. Amen? Amen. Amen. Would you bow with me? You're here this morning and you say, Pastor, man, I'm so busy. Yeah. Let me just say it this way. We are busy. Everybody I know is busy. Students are busy. Parents are busy. Grandparents are busy. Great-grandparents are busy. Retired people are busy. Working people are busy. Everybody's busy. But here's the thing. Just because we're busy doesn't mean God changes his plan for our life. What I've got to do, what we've got to do, is pull back and go, you know what, Lord? I want your will for my life. I want your plan for my life. I want to go, do, and be all you've called me to be. And if it means slowing up in some things in my life, show me that. If it means pulling aside some things and just saying, I need to prioritize you in some areas of my life, show me how to do that. But it all comes down to this. Once you see the need in your own heart and life, then you just say, Lord, forgive me. Just repent. It's all about repent. Repent. Lord, forgive me. I want you to be a priority of my life. I want your plan to be the priority of my life. Lord, I want to see people around me, and I want to love them like you love them. And Lord, I want you to empower me, whatever it would be, to minister to these people. Show me your plan, and I will follow you and be faithful. Friend, that's the great picture of the cross, what Jesus did for us, so that you and I can come into his presence and just kneel before him and say, oh God, cleanse my heart. God will do it. He'll change you. We just got to give him a heart. You may be here this morning and say, you know what, I'm not a Christian. I've never trusted Christ as my Savior. Can I just encourage you this, to say, listen, no one will ever love you like Jesus. Greater love has no man than he that lays down his life for a friend. Can I tell you what? Jesus laid down his life for you. He died for you. That's why he came to this earth, to die for the sins of mankind. He came to serve you by dying for your sins. Would you call upon his name? Would you trust him as your Savior today? If in your heart you say, you know what? I know I need Christ. I know I want to be saved. Call upon his name. Say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for me. I believe you rose again. And Lord, I'm asking you right now, save me. Just fall upon his mercy. Sort of like those beggars did, huh? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy. Is that your heart today? Whatever your need this morning, as we give the invitation in a moment, you come, say yes to Christ. Whatever he lays on your heart, you may just want to come pray. Pray at the altar and ask the Lord to do a great work. Or right where you stand in a moment, just ask the Lord to touch you, change you. Father, I thank you for this time together. Lord, you blessed us with a tremendous opportunity to open your word. And Lord, I pray today that you would just speak to our heart through your spirit, through your word. And Father, as was mentioned a moment ago, that we be hearers of your word and that we obey and be obedient to what it says. Speak to every heart as you see fit. Father, touch and heal lives that are broken. And Father, I pray for cleansing and I pray for forgiveness for those who need to be saved. And Father, I just pray you give them boldness to take a stand for you. And as Christians, Father, help our lives to be, again, pictured by the service of Christ. We give you all the praise and all the honor in Jesus' name. Amen.